up there, we're going to take an adversary's perspective to the IoT today. All that really is just a fancy way of saying we're going to look at this from the outside in, the way an attacker would, rather than from the inside out. Right? Because we're used to the inside out. It's comfortable. Right? It's got benchmarks. It's got best practices. But all of that focus on checklists can really make us hone in on the what of security as opposed to the how. Because when you're reverse engineering your way into something, you got to earn it. You have to learn how something actually works before you can even say what it is to begin with. We've got a ton of stuff we're going to try to crush through in a day. We'll see if we can get through all of it. Going to try to keep it relatively high level, but we're basically going to start off by looking at, just thing working? Yeah, let's do it like that. We're going to look at some stuff in the industrial side of the IoT, including device servers. Device servers are these fun little things that dragged a whole lot of bits of technology that never should have been on the internet onto the internet. Then we're going to switch over to the consumer side of the house, where we're going to have some fun with some zombies on the internet, as well as a little bit of games with some secrets and lies on the devices and their firmware. And finally, we're going to talk about my favorite little thing called SIDET and what that can teach us about IoT ecosystems and how to protect ourselves. So it's a lot, but if you walk out of here with only one thing, I hope you walk out curious, right? Because that's what we really need in the industry at this point, is people to just be curious about how all this different stuff works, yeah? My dad taught me a really important lesson about curiosity and how it can keep you safe. When I was a kid, I was learning about tools. And we're looking at the table saw. He says, all right, boy, what's that? So I gave the predictable answer. He said, no, dummy. You think it's a table saw. It has no idea. That is a big metal box with a power switch and a motor and a sharp piece of steel on it. And that's it. Now, we like it to cut wood. But reality is, it just is what it is. Cut wood, cut nothing, cut your arm. Respect it. Don't pretend like what you want it to be is what it actually is. I tell that story a lot. It stuck with me because I think it's one of the most true things I've ever heard. Labels make us lazy. They just do. And it's true in tools, and it's true in the IoT. I'll give you an example here. This device, no package on it, no marketing. What does it do? What's it for? What can it do? The fact that it's so hard to answer that question without being told by the vendor is what makes the IoT fascinating, and it's what makes reverse engineering something that I just fell in love with. Because asking myself questions like that made me realize, geez, I really take other people's word for it a lot. And sometimes those people are great and they know their stuff, and sometimes it's just a bunch of marketing folks in a room deciding what it is. Now, the good news is, if you want to get the benefit of this, right, you don't have to go tearing every single thing apart in your house. You don't have to have solder burns on your hands. Right? It's really more of a mental exercise from time to time to just think about something for what it actually is. Right? So remembering the table saw, kind of like an OODA loop game, you might see a burglar alarm, right? But what is it really? It doesn't even know what a burglar is. Right? Crack that case open. It's a couple of magnets, it's a sensor, it's an RF transmitter and a battery all tied together into a big system. And like any system, it's based on assumptions. Like that the burglar's gonna come through that door and he's not gonna break the window, he's not gonna jam the frequency for the alarm and all sorts of other things. So if we become hung up on the what of this thing, of its label, we're gonna get tick the box for ourselves. We're gonna pat ourselves on the back for a job well done, and we're gonna get completely creamed by somebody who bothered to absolutely understand its actual implementation. Labels make us lazy. IoT is in itself a label, right? When we hear IoT, we think stuff like this, and that's fair, right? I mean, this is the IoT we deal with most of the time, but it's not the only IoT. There's a lot of stuff out there. There's a lot of bigger stuff out there, right? Frankly, things that if they broke, we'd be a lot more concerned about if we were to find them. When I was getting ready for this talk, I was reading through a bunch of materials, and I found some YouTube videos about for training on industrial control systems. And the instructor was looking at these things called HMIs, right? They're basically just control panels for equipment on the internet. And as he was going through, I noticed in his browser that the URLs were really distinct. So I started writing some of that stuff down, I monkeyed with it a little bit of Google dorking, and I was able to find piles of them, right? And sometimes they're silly, right? Sometimes it's like this car wash in Knoxville. I still don't understand why you need to be able to adjust the foam levels from the internet, but you do your thing. Some of them were a little bit more serious. Right? I know nothing about boilers. I did read a little bit. I learned about what fuel trains are. I learned about the high pressure gas regulators they have on board, and I know that's nothing I should be allowed to futz with on the internet. And there's just piles and piles and piles of this stuff. Right? Somebody give a knuckleful of candy to the person in here who speaks French and understands what's in the lower left-hand corner there. Like it's amazing how much this is out. And this is the stuff that we designed to be on the internet. Right? This stuff is accessed via browser. It's supposed to be there. What about all the stuff that wasn't? Like what about all the stuff that was designed for one-to-one trust models, like serial cables, right? The kinds of things that usually live as you go outside here, take a look at the street corner, those big green boxes, the things that live in field cabinets, right? That interaction was supposed to mean a modem dial-up or a truck roll. Then suddenly, these little guys came out on the scene. Device servers, right? Really simple, really powerful. Like this one. On one side, it's got a serial connection, and on the other side, it's got a network drop, right? So now, no more truck rolls, no more dial-up, right? No more isolated hermit-like existence. You're just on all the time, whether you should be or not. And that's why I call this stuff the original IoT, because everyone's got all wrapped around the axle about, what do we do? My light switch has an IP address, or should we really be putting this stuff out there? We've been jamming stuff that shouldn't be on the internet for a long time. This thing's firmware is in COBOL, right? So this is nothing new at all. Playing with this stuff, I started to get more and more curious. What do you do when you're curious? You start Googling stuff. Google doesn't sound cool, so I OSINTed, right? So I OSINTed all over the place, and I found lots of manuals, and I found the firmware and all sorts of other cool things. I also found a lot of these integration guides for access control systems, fire control systems, and the like. The cool thing about them is they're filled with detail because they want you to get it right on the first try. That much detail, you can start building fingerprints of these devices. And when you can fingerprint something, you can enumerate it on Shodan. And of course, as soon as I say Shodan, I have to say, curiosity is dope, but wrecking other people's stuff is not, right? So I made the decision here to redact things a little bit, didn't go crazy with it. But really, like, just don't monkey with other people's stuff. Go check it out, go look at it, but let's be cool about this. The other thing is, in today's exercises, I had ROE for myself. I didn't try to bypass anybody else's controls. So if you had a password on it, I didn't mess with it. I didn't try to make any other long-term changes. You'll see me doing some things here today that are post-auth. They were all done on LabKit that I own. You can come by afterwards, the InFocus session, and have a little bit of fun with it if you like. Anyway, that's enough of the disclaimers. One of the boxes here that I found, you see that port in red? That was really attractive because in one of the doc sets I found, it said that the device server was running a configuration tool on that port and that it didn't require any authentication, so had to connect to it, try it out, and sure enough, enter for setup mode. I saw this hundreds and hundreds of times. I spent about 25, 30 hours total doing this. I think I enumerated over 12,000 of them. We're gonna look at just a couple of them here. Recognizing that this can get a little bit abstract, so a fun little diagram. We're coming in here and talking on that 9999 port, so we're talking directly to the device server, but if we wanna talk through it to what's on the other side, we'd connect to 10,001, and that would put us on the channel. And if you look to the upper left, that's the configuration for the channel. And we'd be able to talk to it if it weren't for that connect mode C0, because C0 means don't talk to strangers on the internet. It won't let you call in from the outside world. That's great, that's what we want, right? That's security by default. Unfortunately, default security is completely negated by the fact that the setup menu to change the connect mode is exposed with no password on it, but hey, people tried. But even if you don't, and by the way, so we're not gonna connect through here, but if you do wanna play with it and you wanna flip this stuff over, I brought some Arduino kit and some other things. You can play with it in the lab, it'll all be set up. But even if you don't connect through, just connecting to, you can have some real fun, because not all of them are wired. Turns out a bunch of them are actually on Wi-Fi, which is just wonderful, because what could be better than the attacker getting to decide what network your device actually connects to, right? So if I can do this, I can associate to a different hotspot and establish a man-in-the-middle position. Trouble with that is I would need to know where this thing was, right? And so that led to a really fun game of could I, not using the IP addresses because that's cheating, figure out where in the world this thing was based off of the Wi-Fi networks that were nearby. So I kept scanning and scanning and scanning, and it turns out I could. There's only one place that has a Roast Public House, a Whiskey Jack's Madtown, and a Qdoba really close to each other. And that's beautiful Madison, Wisconsin on State Street. Right. You can see it kind of lined up like rickets there. That was a fun moment. There were piles of these things. It's a really fun game to play. This has a happy ending, right? I actually figured out whose this was and tracked them down along with some of the HMI folks as well. But if you thought like there was kind of a creep feeling when I was passing out candy earlier, like try calling somebody on the phone at a bar or at a car wash and explaining what you're looking at on the internet. It's a little bit dicey there, right? So obviously we did this for fun, but a real adversary, this is a retail net entertainment district. Three guesses as to what's going across a serial link in a place like that, right? So some of them were in places like this, but most of them weren't. Most of them were in a bit more rugged conditions. This kind of device server is used in industrial applications. It's actually one of the best features it has is it tunnels industrial automation protocols, IAPs. Specifically, you see some references to Modbus here. That's what that one does. Now, Modbus is used to control stuff like this. Okay? Very different threat model than we had on State Street. There's no credit cards to steal here. But pollute that data set, right? Make the timing change just a little bit, one direction or the other, or just shut it down entirely. You always hear about risks to reputation, revenue, and operations. It doesn't get much more operational than killing somebody's factory line, unless you wanted to, shut down the power, which you can also do. I don't want to beat a dead horse here, but this was a very consistent trend. And you don't need to do the whole security conference FUD thing to know that 13, 14, and 15 in there could really ruin somebody's Valentine's Day night, right? That's going to jack up all their plans. Now, why is this a problem, right? What's going on here? I think one of the administration guides from one of these things explains it really well. A four-character password, not minimum, a four-character password that you have to set, only accessible via Telnet. And if you forget that password, you've bricked your device, you have to RMA it, and it goes back. This is the exact opposite of security. If you could put a gigantic sign out that said, please God, don't put me on the internet, that's about what it would be shaped like. Because think about it, from a security perspective, that four-character password, if you lose it, right, you've got some serious trouble. And you know someone's writing that on a sticky note somewhere, they don't connect to it that often, and now they're locked out. But from an attacker's perspective, a four-character password is not even a speed bump, right? So the trade-off here on that password is you could RMA it, brick your operation, and even if you did do it, I can pick it in a couple of minutes. It's just silly. After seeing a bunch of this stuff, I created a slide that I decided to pull out called Why Aren't We All Dead Yet? Instead, I replaced it with a much more congenial Internet of Bricks. So I think that the reason why this stuff is not on the Internet of Bricks right now is just that COBOL, RS-232, all these old protocols and all these old languages and everything, they're just rare. People just don't spend a lot of time on them, right? Some guys did a Black Hat talk a while ago where they put some honeypots out there that look like ATGs, like the stuff that you run at a gas station. And they found with very, very few exceptions that they got attention, but it was all the silly little commands like checking the tank levels or renaming the tank to I hacked this or whatever else. All the things that you could do with readily available scripts for like nmap and other things like that, right? The really powerful things that you could do, like changing alarm thresholds, changing it so that it looks like there's a leak, making the tank overflow potentially. That kind of stuff rarely got touched. And I don't think it's because people were being nice. I just think this stuff is old and there's way too many other targets out there for people to hit. Security by obscurity like that, it always ends the same way. That said, they are not the only ones with a problem. The consumer side of it's got a whole other side of issues. And this is the 18 million security conference that's talked about IoT security problems on the consumer side. Yeah, it sucks. We don't have to go through that anymore. I'm actually not worried about that issue as much today. I think it's going to all shake out. I think it's going to be fine because it's new tech. And new tech does that, right? We're going to settle on standards and auto updates and requirements, and eventually it'll be fine. But as we evolve, we're not cleaning up after ourselves. And that is the part that can get really ugly, especially when there's a time where it's never been easier to bring a device to market. I used to live down in San Diego, just south of Miramar, which you would never have heard of unless you've seen Top Gun, like everybody. So I lived just south of that, and the hills around my house were a former proving ground. So when the Marines wanted to practice firing off artillery and mortar rounds, they would do it in those hills. Someone decided, hey, it would be way nicer to have that be a park than a demolition site. So they sent in the EODs, they cleaned up a whole bunch of stuff, and it was a park. And I don't know what it's like now, but when I lived there in the early 90s, it was scary, but it wasn't weird for a kid every once in a while to dig out a 5-inch shell after a rainstorm, bring it home, and for the bomb squad to get called out, right? Just because we're done with things does not mean they're done with us by a long shot. In the IoT space, Western Digital, you know them now because they do home consumer storage kind of stuff, right? You're in my cloud offerings. But 2012 and before, they bailed out of the market, I think in 2012, maybe 2013. They were making home internet gateway routers, right? And they made one called the N750 before they ditched it. Easy setup, great little tool, wonderful feature on it. If you forgot the password, you weren't locked out because it wrote your password in plain text on the login page of the device. So a little bit of Shodan, a little bit of scanning. I think I found 270, 280 of these things sitting around, all of them vulnerable. You can see the passwords there for each one of them in red. Let's go play with one of those passwords. Again, doing this on one that I own. We're in the admin panel. We can change we can see the password is super secret. We can change all this kind of stuff, but this ain't State Street. There's no credit cards in here, right? So we found this opportunistically on the internet. I'm not gonna haul off and drive to somebody's house so I can sit in their driveway and be creepy like that. If I'm gonna exploit this, I gotta do it remotely. I don't even wanna put on pants for stuff that's this big. So let's go back to the OSINT. Let's take a look. It turns out it's got a DMZ feature, and not only a DMZ feature with a gigantic flag that says, because of security concerns, use this only as a last resort. What could possibly go wrong? We go in. Three clicks later, I decided to add the printer. To give you an idea of you know, within three clicks what you can do, this was the external attack surface of the network before I added the printer and after I added the printer, right? So a real attacker comes in, they're not gonna do shenanigans like this. I wanted to print things out and annoy my wife, but like the real attacker is gonna set up port forwarding, they're gonna get callbacks going, right? They're gonna establish a presence in the environment. But that might make you say, so what? You found some old piece of garbage on the internet and you're able to hack it. That's kind of the default state of many, many things. And I agree with you, except for one thing. The Western Digital company left the router market, but the router market did not leave Western Digital. You can still buy this thing on Amazon today for $50. It's got a 4-star rating. In fact, it's got a lot of reviews, which you gotta read. Setup has quite a few options that aren't clearly explained, but it's no big deal. You can totally get through it. Gotta look at some of the other ones. Very consistent trend here, right? There's two groups of people that were buying this. There are people like me who wanna go load like a custom firmware on it, and then there were all these other poor folks that were like, I bought this thing and all of a sudden it's just really slow, I don't know why. It drops all the time. My personal favorite, I put a password on all by itself, right? Like, this is happening. Like, it's brutal, right? And like, it is absolutely funny and you should laugh, this sucks. But also, God, think about our friends and family and neighbors here. Like, not everybody's a geek. Most people don't know what a CVE is. Like, what chance did this guy have? He went on the Amazon, he bought something, it had 4 stars, he brought it home, and it was a piece of garbage, right? Now, that should make us all mad, but if you're in the IoT industry, it should freak you out. Because consumers get in the shaft like this, like, that's usually the sound you hear right before government regulation steps in hard, right? Asus learned this last year. They were advertising their router as the most secure thing. Spoiler, it was not the most secure thing. And now the FTC is overseeing their security program, including audits for the next 20 years. I can't believe Asus is even gonna be around in 20 years, let alone getting dug into it like that. Now, again, even if you don't care about the individuals, even if you're out of the IoT game and you don't care about regulation, we're in an ecosystem. This stuff impacts all of us eventually, right? Today's takeover victim is tomorrow's DDoS node. That's the stuff that's gonna hit us, and we need to figure out a way to make it go away. Now, one of those ways to make it go away that you hear people talk about a lot is, well, let's just start we'll educate people, and we'll teach them how to do this, and they'll update their firmware, like they check their smoke detector batteries, and it's gonna be great. Play that game out on this device. So you come in, you click the check now button, note 2012, good news, you're on the latest version of the firmware, because they stopped making firmware because they walked away from this thing. And this is a horrible example of it, but it's a relatively common one. It's just a bummer. In fact, this kind of stuff, this kind of security, isn't malicious, it's just shit, right? And I'll give you an example of it. These guys actually tried to do the right thing. If you look at the login page where your password is stored in plain text, this is a little snippet from it. They knew that someone might go looking through there, control F, type admin, looking for admin. So A plus D plus M plus I, that was their attempt at obfuscation, right? And now you can't fix this at scale. Now these things are just jammed and they're stuck. Somebody asked me the other day, like, what's the size of this problem? How bad is it? It's really hard to tell. We don't know the buying cycles yet. But if we look at firmware update rates, like, people don't do it very often. This is Android, since we're gonna be looking at mobile next. Less than 1% are on the version that was released a few months ago. 50% are on something 2 years behind. In fact, if you only take one thing out of this, more people are on Gingerbread from 6 years ago than are on Nougat. So all things being equal, your tech is more likely to be 6 years than 6 months old. That's not a new problem in this industry, right? We've had that problem forever. When we pay teams of people to maintain patches on servers in the data center, they still fall behind. So we can't exactly be shocked that when we handed these out to members of the public that they were gonna, you know, do silly stuff with it. Since we're talking about data centers, another thing about data centers is that a lot of our trust models are based off of them, right? We've always believed that if I needed a computer to tell me the truth or to keep my secret, I had to maintain physical control over it. And we've brought everybody up on that concept. Like, we all went to school on that, or we all learned on that, and now all of a sudden it's not true anymore. Now these things are all sitting in people's pockets. So probably the best way to show that off is to see if we can make a mobile application live for us. Let's imagine a world just like this one for the most part, but it's a world where you're about 35% less ethical than you are right now. and your company sent you to a security conference, you're having a good time, it's fun, this dude's got candy, but every once in a while it sucks, right? Everyone wants to go back to their room. You want to go catch up with some work, take a nap, it's a pretty day out, whatever. Usually you could play hooky, but not this year. Because this year, hypothetically, they put in a geo-tracker, and they track how many hours you spend at the conference, right? And they share that information with your colleagues, and that includes your boss, right? So goodbye, free time. But you remember then that you don't believe in table saws and burglar alarms, right? This thing doesn't actually know you're at the conference. When it turned on, it asked for your location permission, so really, it's built a geofence. As long as GPS says that you're inside of that little rectangle, it starts the clock running, and as soon as you cross 3rd Street, it knocks it back down again. So you don't actually have to be there, it just has to think that you're there, right? So one way that you could do that would be to spoof your GPS and trick the thing. Good news, you've got a nice little rooted phone in your bag, you pull it out, go to install this bad boy on it, get it running, all excited, and no, Jeannie Bueller shows up. You're not allowed to run it. They've got root detection on this thing. The developers knew people were gonna try some sneaky things like this, right? And they decided to run a test. When the app first starts up, it's gonna check. Does this thing look like it's rooted? If it does, no joy, and it won't start up. This is where I see the big gap between enterprises and adversaries, by the way. When I talk to a lot of people, they say things like, we have a compensating control. They talk a lot about labels. Right? I hear things like, I have a WAF, or I have root detection, or cert pinning, or anything else. The reality is, no, it's all in the how it was actually implemented, right? And 35% less ethical you knows that, highly adversarial you knows that. You know that it isn't magical monolith of root detection, it's looking at your device, and it's spotting a tell, something that's giving you away. So if you figure out how to smooth out that wrinkle, you can get it. And this is RSA, I know you guys like to keep it classy, we're not gonna do the sort of low-hanging fruit, you know, automated cloaker kind of stuff, let's go reverse engineer it. So a little bit of APK tool, a little bit of Jeb, and we find it. Two places in this application it's looking for you. The first one, it tries to run sue, as in switch user to root, right? So if it can run sue, it's probably a rooted device. The other thing it does is look for talroot, because that's an app that's commonly used to root Android devices. If it sees tr.apk on there, it also nukes out. But if it doesn't, what happens? You're not even running talroot, so you're good there, and in a cunning little bit of subterfuge, you're gonna come in with this bit of tradecraft. You're gonna rename Sue, not Sue, because you're sneaky like that. We're gonna see if it works, right? So close it out, fire it back up again, and boom, it does. Now, your afternoons are yours again, congratulations. But I mocked this one up. I didn't oversimplify it. This is the state of root detection on the majority of the apps that have it. This is the state that they're in for the most part. In fact, an app that's used for parents to keep track of their kids, I worked on it about 10 days ago, and that was exactly how it was set up on there. Now, there's this guy, Ben Actis. He's like my Android Yoda, puts it really well. If you play Pokemon Go, that has better root detection than your banking and IoT apps, right? And I can say that as somebody who's looked at a whole bunch of this stuff, he's absolutely right. And that's a bummer, because this is one of the few places where the asymmetry is on the defender's side. Right, you can jack up the attacker cost for very, very little effort, very, very little resource investment, and have some pretty cool stuff happen as a result. You can think of it in the terms of off-ramps. I know we're running a little bit short on time here. But in terms of our off-ramps, this is just places where somebody could quit, where they could give up. If there's no root detection, green line, straight to attack town. If it's there, they have to make a choice. Do they want to keep working or not? Keep working or not? And every time you make them go through one of those gates, three really cool things happen. One, you increase attacker costs, it's harder to get you. Two, you make it so that there's fewer people who can attack you, because once you get past all the script kiddie stuff, now someone's gotta be able to reverse engineer to do any of this stuff. And then three, my personal favorite, I call it the Wardle effect. If anybody knows who Patrick Wardle is, he's our head of R&D, he's always popping Apple devices. Patrick lives way out on the far right-hand side of this stuff, okay? And as a consequence, when he finds a vulnerability in an Apple product, people say, wow, like Patrick Wardle's legit. Wardle is a verb at Apple, right? No one's saying, very few people are saying, Apple security sucks. You can leverage that same thing. If you understand where you are on that spectrum and you choose your position there by not just being happy with the what, but really understanding the how, then you can decide. You can't choose if someone finds a vulnerability or not, but you can choose what people are gonna think. If they're gonna say, like, of course he found a vulnerability, or wow, who's the guy who found that? That's legit, right? Just one of those things you can do. Let's jump through some of this other stuff. We're behind on time, so now let's go ahead and extract some secrets out of a device. We're gonna do that by attacking the firmware. The first step in that process is to just get your hands on the firmware itself. right? Now, sometimes that's from the internet because they're nice enough to make it available on a downloads page. Other times you have to yank it straight out of the device. But once you get it, you're gonna start trying to carve it up and analyze it so you can use it to launch attacks. Launching it against yourself on a piece of equipment, you know, it's boring. You wanna go in two directions. You wanna either hit servers on the internet, so like their APIs, right, their S3 buckets, we'll talk about that, and then also other devices. So like if you find a hard-coded password on one of these devices and it turns out there are all these other devices out there that are also using it, now you can go hit those guys directly. Now, there's a ton of stuff. We're never gonna get into it. I've got blogs out there on this if you guys are interested. Sometimes they make it really easy for you, and there's literally just these three wires, right? A listen, a talk, and a ground to keep the difference and keep everything copacetic, plugged into a $6 part off of Amazon, and you can talk to this thing. Or at least you can communicate with it, right? Whether or not that port's open is really up to the vendor. Sometimes they go tight, sometimes they stay loose and just assume that whoever's on there is a tech and they're valid. Other times, this is where, by the way, I really fell in love with reverse engineering. You have to break out the logic analyzer. So what you're looking at there up there on the top is the voltage on the pin. Up, down, 1, 0, 1, 0, because that's when you boil it all down, that's how we transmit information. If you got a bunch of time, you can sit there and try to reverse engineer that. If you're lazy or short on time, that logic analyzer has a fun tool that says, hey, breaking this all down into bits and then putting it together into bytes, it looks like it says B-O-O-T-A-T, boot at. Hey, this is a place where I can listen to this thing boot. And that's how you figure it out from there. Now, whether you had to reverse engineer the protocol or you just plugged into it or you just downloaded it off of the internet, the next thing you gotta do is try to get your hands on the firmware and read through it. Not designed for your eyes, it's gonna look something like this. It's gonna be a bit miserable. So, you get yourself a nice fun tool like Binwalk, which is awesome. Binwalk does that grunt work for you. And it goes and cuts through the file looking for little things that point out what things could be. And in this case, I've snipped it and cleaned it up a bit. It says, hey, I found a uImage header. Basically, I found a file label. And it's for this compressed image, and it's labeled Linux kernel image. And then sure enough, the next file down, that 327744, is a compressed image. So now we're gonna extract it. That last command in white, that looks scary, but all it's saying is, hey, I want you to take that firmware binary, I want you to skip ahead to where the Lisma file starts and carve it out and call it kernel.lisma. You're just gonna do that over and over and over again in lots of different ways. I don't wanna pretend like this is super easy. It can be a serious pain in the ass. You will miss social obligations and meals and sleep when you get into this, but again, it's really, really fun. The goal is to extract stuff like this, right? Hard-coded passwords, or public keys, private keys, any kind of information you can use in an upstream attack. One of our guys found a great one just a couple of days ago. The firmware was making references. Candy, give that lady candy. Derek's around here somewhere, we'll hook you up. Good, see, I was hoping one person was gonna be able to see that in there. So what he did was he saw these references to S3, right, which is like buckets for storage. And that's where they were keeping the images, the pictures that were taken by the device. And because they were secure, they also had an API key, which was sitting right next to the reference calls for the images. Unfortunately, that API key was for the entire bucket and not just for your pictures. So by swimming back all the way to the top of it and then browsing through and forcing his way through the directory, he was able to download other people's pictures, other people's chat history, stuff about what was going on in their house, et cetera, right? The game, again, is just to grab as much of this stuff as you can and then just figure out how it's gonna work later. So after talking about this, let's revisit something like this, right? What is it? Hopefully we're at least, before we didn't know, but at least now we know that, okay, we don't know and that's meaningful, right? And then we have to spend some time understanding it because it's marketed as a webcam, a terrifying webcam, by the way. I have it sitting with me. It's got some serious stuff going on with it. But if we take the manufacturer's word for it and we treat it like a camera, we're gonna miss out on the fact that it really, it's a very well-connected Linux server sitting in our house with a camera, a speaker, and a microphone, and it doesn't know it's supposed to be a camera. It'll be whatever the software tells it that it's supposed to be, right? That's particularly important when we talk about SIDET, sympathetic detonation. This is what happens when an explosion occurs and the force of that explosion detonates nearby explosive material. And people in here who know me know that one of my hobbies is blowing stuff up. It's tons of fun. SIDET puckers me. Right, because SIDET can happen when you're transferring explosives from one place to another. It can get real bad real quick. And what you're seeing in this diagram is not just bang, bang. You're seeing the chain reaction that happens when you have a lot of it. Bang, 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 right? It can get ugly. We've often wondered what that SIDET moment would be like in the IoT, right? And we got a first taste of it last fall with Brian Krebs, right? Brian writes an article calling out some people that were selling DDoS services for hire. They didn't like that. And in retaliation, they shot what, like, I think it was like 620 gigs, 680 gigs, something like that, a second, sustained at him. They hit him so hard that Akamai had to invoke lifeboat ethics and kick him off platform because he was gonna take everybody else down with him, and a very similar looking thing here. Now, once he finally got back up, he wrote an article that we'll talk about in a second. But before we get there, anybody remember Abbeville, the attacks against the banks like 4 years ago, right? When that happened, Akamai came out and said, there is no way that this could be a bunch of hacktivists. This 62 gigs, at that point, 62 gigs sustained, that had to be a nation state. Flash forward 4 years, and a 10x sized attack is being done by a criminal organization. That's why we need to care about the IoT. That's why this stuff is important. We should be curious about it. This was the article he wrote when he first came back, obviously much longer than this, but what we're allowing by our inaction is for individual actors to build the instrumentality of tyranny. And to be clear, these weapons can be wielded by anyone with any motivation who's willing to expend a modicum of time and effort to learn the most basic principles of its operation, right? First of all, I wish I could write like that. Second of all, hopefully in seeing some of this stuff today, you got a little taste for just how easy some of that stuff is to do, right? That it's really not that hard. That it really is just that we're kind of lucking out on this stuff and that everybody's feasting on, you know, interconnected blenders and whatnot, and they're not really going after any of the bigger stuff that's out there in the space. When I read that, I thought the reason it stuck with me was that it scared me. Doesn't scare me. Pisses me off, right? Because he's right. We're allowing by our inaction. Everybody in this room, everybody at this conference, we're the security industry. We're it. Like, everybody out there thinks we've got it together and that we're going to address this issue. So we've officially lost the right to wring our hands and say this sucks, or oh, what are we gonna do when this hits our borders now? We've all gotta really come together and figure out some ways to address it. I'd love to have that conversation with the time that we have left. They told me I had to give you guys an apply slide too, so that's what this is. You can tell I put a lot more thought into this one. One, map your attack surface. Know what the heck you look like, right? And know how you know what you look like, right? Inside and out. If you're a large organization or you've got a lot of remote sites, go find the person who pays your wireless bills. Go get that person to give you a list of any data-only packages that you're paying for, because that's probably got like a Sierra wireless card hanging off of it. A lot of those HMIs that I found, by the way, they were just sitting out there on mobile networks, right? Not only could it be some IoT that you care about, those sorts of things could also very easily be bridges back into across all of your well-planned defenses. The other one is just good old-fashioned adversarial alignment. Focus on the how and the what. If you're paying somebody to do a pen test or a vulnerability assessment, right, you are paying them to be your sparring partner. We lose sight of that. That person's job is to emulate adversarial threat so that you can understand what it's going to look like when you go out in the wild. So if they suck, you're not going to have good data, and you're not going to be able to optimize it. And even if they're great, it's really important to understand that it's not binary. You're on a spectrum, right? So how far do they take it so that you can know what you can expect in an environment like that and build a suit? Your security doesn't have to be perfect. Nobody's is. But you should at least be making an intentional decision for where you want to be. Next one is, we really do actually need to educate people to help them understand this, if not because they're going to update their firmware, but then just because we need more people out there fighting the good fight. If we try to send people to computer-based trainings, compliance stuff, for 45 minutes, we're done. Like, when was the last time you actually paid attention to one of those, right? Everybody clicks. So I'm like, I've seen people put more effort into cheating those things than they would have put into actually, like, clicking through it. He's laughing. I did it to ours. Like, it was one JavaScript element set to yes, and hey, I got through 4 hours of training in, like, 5 minutes. It was great. But, you know, we need to be focused on that. Remember that these people who are blowing off the compliance training are the same people who go home, kick off their shoes, and watch Mr. Robot. This is the sexiest field in the world. Don't blow that opportunity, right? Everyone's gonna blow off the mandatory compliance training. No one ever blows off the come learn how to hack this thing lunch and learn, right? Show people how to do that kind of stuff and they get into it. We had a lot of success at our company with phishing around that. We were making people do phishing training and everybody's blowing it off. But then when we flipped it and said like, okay, you're gonna create the phishing campaigns and let's see who you can catch and what you would put out there, man, people invested pretty darn quick. And we had some nice results for it. Next is, it might be time to start thinking about search and rescue. Now, I'm not a hugger by a long shot, but harm reduction is something that we really need to think about here. As an industry, we could go down the path where we all try to build our networks to be able to handle the sustained 620 gigs or whatever that Krebs took, right? But that doesn't do anything. One, it costs us piles of money, and two, today it's 620, as we saw, this thing's exploding, right? So that's not the right path. Maybe the right path is to make it easier to catch some of this stuff out there and to really force this issue, right? Maybe not bug bounty necessarily, because I think that implies that the vendor is gonna like work with you and be involved in it, and I don't want anybody to pop anything. But when we see something, we should be able to say something, right? And if might be time to start thinking about passing the hat to make something like that go down. Because if we can lock some of this stuff now, one, we can slow the tide of it coming on so we can cut that rate of growth. And then two, we might be able to actually, you know, make things better. And then finally, just be curious. Again, this stuff is just so much fun. And one of the things that really breaks my heart about the security industry is our ego. Like, we're really scared of people finding out that we don't know everything. We're all experts, right? Like, nobody's an expert in this, though. This is all too new. There's people who know a lot, but there's nobody who's like the rock star that owns it. So just go learn about it. Go play with it. If you want to learn about it and you're not sure where to start, hit me up after this. I think my Twitter handle's on this thing, too. I'm never on there, but you can hit me. Like, I would happily set you guys up with some stuff. I don't know everything. I'm not going to walk you through all the pieces. But as for what you could go buy on Amazon and stuff you should read, I can absolutely give that to you. And he's given me the sign that says we got 5 minutes, and I'm supposed to do at least 5 minutes of questions. So that sounds like we came in perfect there. 5 minutes until questions. All right, well, we're already there now. Who's got candy and who wants questions? If not, you guys can grab candy on the way out. We can duck out of here early. It'll be great. Anybody? That's either a really good or a really bad sign. Okay, thanks, everybody. Appreciate you coming out.